My parents were refugees, and my father insisted that I make sure my science, maths, was first, was the first priority, and then English and other things were a priority. But he really made sure I could get a job in science and engineering and things like this were the best bets, okay? And they still are. Well, my main interest was graphic art and drawing, things like that. And I had a teacher, Mr. Higginson, who gave me extra lessons. And then when I went along the science side, because you stopped art at the age of 15, and it wasn't sort of a subject, an academic subject. And I was good at science, physics, chemistry. My maths was good, but I think you have to, in physics, you have to really be stronger in maths than I was, although I was pretty strong at it, and chemistry came more naturally, and hands-on, pouring things and making smells and blowing things up and blowing teachers up if possible and things like this. And I liked the science teacher, a guy called Mr. Jerry, I got on well with him, less well with the physics teacher. Well, he was all right, but you had class with some teachers more than others. And then particularly a teacher called Harry Heaney came, a young teacher, and he gave me extra chemistry lessons. And he took a group of three or four of us, and we were back for tea with his wife made tea for 4 or 5 hours, and we thought we're going to be good at chemistry. So I ended up doing chemistry. I followed his advice to go to Sheffield University to do a degree in chemistry. I wasn't really thinking of doing chemistry the rest of my life. I was wanted to go on to university, and when I got there, I ended up pretty good at chemistry. Then I wanted to do a PhD, and I wanted to stay at university. I was having such a good time. I was editor of the magazine, the student magazine. I was playing tennis for the university, and we were a pretty good team, actually. Got to the finals a couple of times. Margaret was there. This was my girlfriend at the time, and so there are lots of good reasons for doing it. And obviously to do a PhD in chemistry was the obvious thing, so that's it. And then I had got the PhD, and we got married, and I was offered a postdoc in Canada. I thought, well, let's go and live in Canada. So that still wasn't, wasn't really great. It was more, I was good at chemistry, I got a PhD, I wanted to do a postdoc, I wanted to live in another country. And then after 2 years there, I thought I wanted to live in the States, so we went to the States for a year, and then I was asked to come back to the University of Sussex by a professor at Sheffield, who was now a professor at Sussex, to come back and as a postdoc initially set up a spectroscopy group. So we went back, and I thought, well, let's give it 5 years. If it works, then that's fine. If it doesn't work, I'll go to night school with graphics and do something I really want to do. Chemistry worked. My father was a refugee, and he would make me work until my homework was finished, until about the age of 13. So, I mean, I was pretty lucky to get to this school because the refugees didn't have any money, and I think today it would be very difficult for me to be in the same situation to come to the school. I would have to win the scholarships. I don't know how I got in. My father was saying my mother sort of browbeat the headmaster of the junior school or something. She was a pretty interesting lady. She was a middle European, and she was a strong character. And my father insisted that I do my homework, and he used to check it. So he used to check, because he hadn't gone past the age of 15 to school, because he was born in 1900, but he actually was quite good at maths, and he wanted to follow me in mathematics also, so he really got calculus. He got to calculus, but he wasn't able to follow it, which is sort of interesting. So he gave up at that point. And at that point, I went on by myself, and I decided I was going to do it all by myself. So by that time, I had the bug of working and doing something to the best of my ability. And I wasn't good at everything. I was very good at geography, which is a very good subject to be good at and to like, because it's such an interesting, wide-ranging, because you've got science, geology, anthropology, human things and all. It's a wide-ranging subject. I was not very good at languages. I worked at it, but it was for communication. For me, English was the language, and my parents were German, and I don't want to speak. I could speak German. I could speak a bit of German, not very well. But, so you don't, they didn't want to speak German in 1945, 47, just after the war. And so science was what I worked best at. And I did history, and I occasionally got good marks in English and stuff like that. So I did it as well as I possibly could. And it was probably my father keeping my nose to the grindstone until about the age of 13. At that point, I said, I want to do it by myself. And anyway, I passed him by anyway, because I was doing differential equations and stuff like that. I was getting interested in those, physics and chemistry, yeah. So I worked hard. And I've always worked hard. And I'll work till 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning just to make sure my presentation is good. So it's, it is hard work. And that's got me where I am. And the question is whether I want to be where I am. Sometimes think about it. But in fact, something that I missed out on my talk, Margaret reminded me, the discovery that we made of the C60 molecule, one of the major clues to what it was an interest in architecture and Buckminsterfuller's domes, which have the same geometric pattern. And it was that, because I was interested in graphics, that I had this magazine with this image. And so I said, well, I've got this magazine, it's at home in England. And we went to get Buckminsterfuller's book, and that was a clue to what the structure might be. So again, that was something I missed, of bringing the synthesis. What was important here, and certainly my contribution to determining what the structure of this molecule might be, was that I had an interest in architecture. I'd been to Buckminsterfuller's dome in Montreal, and I had this magazine called Graphics, which is a graphic art magazine, and there was an image in there which was in my mind and always had been. And it was that said, we should get Buckminsterfuller's book. And so again, synthesis is what I'm talking about, is bringing together sort of ideas from various areas. And you never know which ones are going to be there, but this was one of them. Yeah. One in 100 who sees the beauty the Taylor expansion. Now, I always remember when I had the Taylor expansion of e to the x, and the differential of e to the x, it jumps one step, the first one, you differentiate one, it's, it goes, x goes to 1, x squared over 2, fractional goes to x, and so on. And I saw that, and I thought, I could have died happy if I discovered that. And it's that aspect that, I feel sorry that only 1 out of 20 kids will ever get that feeling. Wow, that's really clever and beautiful. In the same way that Ry Cooder's music, I mean, that slide guitar, that I used to try slide guitar, it's not easy, but I see the same, what's the word, appreciation and beauty in the music or painting in particular. Great paintings, which are my main interest, as I do in something like mathematics or physics or DNA. I mean, the structure of DNA has got to be the most fantastic structure we've ever seen, because in that structure, outfalls all our understanding of how we have evolved. And so, teaching is about that. Because you can't teach things about which you're not passionate. So what I'm trying to do, and John is part of that, and is to get people who are brilliant teachers and capture those nuggets of genius, specific ideas that they have found by experience are good at transmitting enthusiasm and empathy for those things to students. So what I'm doing with JSET is turning the whole sort of strategy around by 180 degrees. Instead of they asking who are you focusing on, I'm focusing on the teacher. So we now have the technology to capture every clever, I don't like the word gimmick, but I can't find an alternative. Gimmick is sort of implies something up, but every clever idea that teachers had had to explain a particular I think now I'm really very happy that we've got an educational program called GSET, Global Educational Science, Outreach for Science, Engineering and Technology, which I think we've got a set up here where we're recording students like you talking about your own approaches, things that you're interested in. I'm really very happy, and that's the thing I'm most pleased with at the present time. I'm working very hard to make sure that schools like yours, like this one, are going to get involved. And you record presentations of things that you personally are interested in. That's turning out to be really good. So I'm very pleased with that. And I'm sure there are other things, but I don't think there are things I'm not so proud of as well. I won't tell you about those, but those are things that I think are important as well, that you accept the responsibility for the things that are good, and also personal responsibility for things that are not so good and sometimes difficult. But some people manage to go to talk to somebody and they absolve them from the blame of whatever they're doing, you know. I'll stick you on that. So there are quite a wide range. I don't think anything in particular, but obviously the Nobel Prize has got to be something that every scientist has got to be somewhat satisfied with.